Well, Shane, after 30 years with the RFS and 12 years as Commissioner, you're leaving the organisation. Not an easy decision, I guess.
No, it's been one of the most difficult decisions in my career, to be honest. It's having been in the organisation now as a volunteer and a staff member, starting out in the early 80s, mid 80s, spending a wonderful decade or so there as a volunteer before transitioning into the department back in September of 94, actually, when the watershed event back then was the January 94 fires and government investment in big change across the organisation. I landed a role as a regional planning officer in Central East region, as it was then, after a few failed attempts at trying to get jobs in local council, but then I've been with the department in its various forms ever since, and now Commissioner for the last 12 years. So it's actually, like, very genuinely, a very large family, the Royal Fire Service. I've always talked about that, and I've always talked about how much I love the organisation, but more importantly, the people in the organisation that make up the organisation, what they do, why they do it. There's something very special about that, and to be making a decision to decide to move on and do something different was extremely difficult. But as I've said already, the really important decisions, the necessary decisions, are always the most difficult, and this has certainly been one of the most difficult I've ever made.
So looking back over the past 30 years or so, what are some of the biggest changes that you've seen during that time?
Oh, there's no doubt we've seen massive changes in technology. Technology is an enabler to support business. We've seen a tremendous growth in systems, in programs. And what I mean by that is not just technology systems and programs, but I'm just talking about programs of work, programs of support, mental health and well-being, the psychological and emotional welfare and support for the organisation, the program of getting it out there, openly talking about it, but following it through with peer support teams, dedicated personnel, and, you know, referral to professional services for staff and volunteers alike. We've seen massive changes to infrastructure, to equipment, to buildings, to the state centre, the control centres. How many control centres we saw in those early days that were just a back room in a council chambers or a council depot or some old second-hand building that we could get our hand on and refurbish and make into some sort of a control centre and an operations centre. Whereas today, you know, we've got leading technology, leading platforms of operation and systems of work. It's been absolutely massive. But the core to all that has been our people. We've seen people grow and diversify. We are seeing good numbers in volunteer membership. We are always well subscribed when it comes to advertising for jobs. We've always got lots of people applying for jobs. Yes, we've got some challenges in some of the always challenging recruit areas in far west and remote areas, but generally speaking, we are very fortunate to have people wanting to work with the organisation, wanting to join the organisation as a volunteer. We've seen some pretty significant growths in that volunteering after major events, particularly the October 13 period, where we saw the average number of 3,500 new members a year going to over 6,000, and this season we're already up over 8,000 members, and that's been curtailed a bit because we can't hold meetings. So the people have really grown and developed. We've seen massive learnings from our own fire seasons here in New South Wales, but also across the country and around the world. And just in the last decade alone, there is no doubt the biggest transformation in the way we do business has been around resetting the fire danger ratings and then correlating public information and warnings to that. And as I've said very publicly already, despite all the arsenal, despite all the firefighting effort, the advancement in aircraft and heavy aircraft, large air tankers, but lots of machinery on the ground and a fleet, you know, as modern and as large as it's ever been, the information and warnings, getting information to people, getting people prepared, letting them know what the risk is, letting them know when that risk escalates and asking them to do certain things, there's no doubt in my mind that has contributed to saving lives. And the research is showing that, as tragic as 25 lives lost this season has been, the numbers we should have been counting in the hundreds if it wasn't for all those interventions. So lots of learnings, a continuous learning culture, and significant advancements in technology, equipment, infrastructure, the growth of our people, the development of our people. We've never seen more highly credentialed, highly trained and skilled people ever across our very broad workforce. It's fantastic.
You touched upon the most recent bushfire season, and it was so challenging in so many different ways.
Oh, it's this last season has been truly awful in so many ways. It's a season that I've openly said to anybody, I don't know how you can go through this season and not be personally affected, and not be, whether you've been directly involved or whether you've been indirectly involved, I don't think there's anybody that's experienced this season that hasn't been affected by it. And it has been awful. It's been horrific. We've seen the tragic loss of 25 lives. We saw two lives lost in October. We saw another seven lives lost in November. We saw another five lives lost in December, and then 11 lives lost in January. It's just an awful toll that weighs heavy on everybody. And behind all those homes that have been lost, the nearly 2,500 homes, buildings, infrastructure, livelihoods, it's all been affected and disrupted by these fires. And behind every one of those statistics, there's a name, there's a family, there's an individual, there's a community, and that's affected us all. For me personally, this season took a massive toll, but I'm not alone. I've had plenty of conversations with people that we're working with downstairs in the operations centre, those that were doing it really hard in control centres, making really important and critical decisions, looking after the welfare of firefighters on the front line, affecting information to the community, all those sorts of things. And of course, the men and women on the front line, you know, putting themselves between fire fronts and people's valuables, it's affected everybody. It's taken a massive toll. But together, individually and collectively, we will get through it. The good thing today, compared to when I first started in this organisation, there's a very open, honest, transparent dialogue around not feeling okay, which we didn't have in the past, and we've got that now, which is going to be absolutely fundamental to going forward and letting everybody get through this. There is no doubt the most tragic of events for me this season, without being disrespectful or insensitive to everybody that suffered loss, you can't go past our six firefighters, the three aircrew that were in Bomber 134 that crashed down near Cooma, absolutely tragic. And as we said at their memorial, and their colleagues said, you'd be hard pressed to find a greater collection of experience inside a C-130 Hercules aeroplane. The combination of the expertise in that plane was just extraordinary. So to see them lost in an awful accident was just horrible. But of course, our three volunteers, Jeff and Andrew, who tragically lost their life when that tree came down right into the front windscreen of their truck while they were driving down the road there. And then of course, Sam, down near the border, when that extraordinary weather event flipped his truck over while he was working on the back of the truck. All three members died instantly, and it just doesn't get worse than that. It just does not get worse than that. And only this last week over Easter and this week, I had the chance to make a quick phone call to Jess and to Mel and to Megan, just remarkable young, strong women still working through the grief of losing their loved ones. It's really tough. It doesn't get any tougher than that.
We saw the toll that it took on people, and you standing up as a trusted figure during the fires. How does that sit with you?
I still find it quite difficult, but I have always said that in whatever leadership role you've got, I think you've just got to be authentic. And I just tried to be very honest and very clear with whatever we were dealing with, whether it was information, whether it was expressing how I feel. Don't get me wrong, I know we've all got this job as leaders at whatever level we are, where our tradition is you don't want to get too emotional. You've got a real responsibility to get clear information out, keep people calm. And if you're not calm and you're not controlled, then how do you expect others to do that? You're trying to emulate what you're looking for. But at the end of the day, I'm human like everybody else, and I have found it quite uncomfortable going out and being more recognised, and I've even had some really, you know, lovely things happen, but which are quite embarrassing. When I ducked out for dinner with my family when I was home one night when it all started raining, it was fantastic. We had blackouts, so we couldn't do much at home. We went up to the local Thai restaurant and we sat down to eat a quick meal. And people were looking at us and we just nodded away thinking, you know, we knew them. And then we recognised we did know them. But then as they walked out, they just put the bit of paper on the table and said, your meal's been paid for. And I said, you can't do that. And this guy said, don't tell me what to do, mate. It's okay. You know, so little things like that I found really uncomfortable, but they are lovely. As someone said to me just recently, because I didn't quite get it, to be honest, and it's like the incident controllers, the firefighters, they're going just doing their thing every day. We're all in this operation of trying to do the very best we can day after day. So we're in an operational mode. And, you know, for those of us that have got to get up and speak on camera or whatever, you just don't appreciate the time, how many people are tuning in and how much repetition is going on day after day, multiple times a day, doing live interviews and having people tune in. And someone described it to me in a very funny way. You know, the reality is you don't see it, but you've been living your own bushfire Big Brother type scenario. There's been cameras on what the organisation's been doing, what people have been doing for many, many months. So people know a lot about what's going on, what you're doing. They're seeing you every day. You might not see that because you're not actually attuned to that. Yes, there's cameras sitting in front of you, but at the end of the day, we'll just focus on trying to get the job done and to have the firefighters from the front line through the IMTs, getting information into ICON, getting it through to the state level, having our public information and warnings team, pulling all that together, you know, in moments to try and get time and accurate information out. That was the big focus at the same time as all the real firefighting effort. And our job in the media was to actually relay that. So without the systems, without the programs, without the technology, and without the organisation of everybody up the line, we couldn't deliver that messaging. So I have found it really difficult and somewhat uncomfortable because all I was doing was my part in the chain of what we were trying to do with the firefighting effort and with the public information and warnings and providing regular and reliable updates. So, yeah, it's been difficult.
The recovery process has really just started for the communities and the people impacted by the fires, and now you're going to be one of the leaders in that space. It's a pretty big challenge.
It's a massive challenge. And the thing that really appealed to me when I was approached about this new role was that it is something different. It is. We have just been through unprecedented bushfire season and bushfire disaster for New South Wales, but that was on top of an underlying awful statewide drought situation. Remembering only a few months ago, we were looking at towns and villages and areas that were literally running out of water. Our investment and our partnering with other government agencies was to look at water supplies and bulk water supplies and reliable water supplies into some of these areas, not just for firefighting, but for existence. So we've had the drought effect, we've had the extraordinary bushfire effect with the geographic spread. It's not like a normal recovery event where you've got a bushfire somewhere on the north coast or the south coast or out in the central west where there's an area impacted that requires concentrated effort over the next period of time. You've got statewide drought effect. You know, 100% of the state was drought affected there. You've got bushfire events with extraordinary damage being occasioned from the Queensland border to the Victorian border, right across the Great Dividing Range and out to the coastal areas. In a number of locations, we saw the drought and the fire risk season issues get broken by strong weather events, rain, storms, winds. So we've got people that have been affected by drought, bushfires, storm and flooding events, and now everybody has got the extraordinary overlay of the COVID-19 virus pandemic. So the recovery effort is extraordinary. And for an unprecedented set of circumstances, an unprecedented fire season, I found it very, very impressive and therefore very appealing that the government wanted to seriously invest in a new way, a very enhanced way of dealing with what was now an unparalleled recovery effort for the state of New South Wales. So the role appealed to me, and I've said for a while that I never want to outstay my relevance or welcome in the organisation. I think all of us have got to pick a time to leave. This, in my mind, just no matter how difficult it was the right time to leave. And going into this new role, as challenging and as demanding as it's going to be, I think it's an area where I can contribute, where I can hopefully make a difference and be part of the government's commitment to looking after the people of New South Wales, particularly those that have been so terribly devastated as a result of this season. So the three priorities I've been given are recovery, recovery, recovery. But the broader remit is not just about recovery in the resilience space. It's actually about better preparation, better planning, better arrangements across the entire emergency management sector for the state, closer tie-ins with the Commonwealth and the national agenda and our international partners. So there's a pretty significant remit there which appeals to me, and I'm really looking forward to working with the team and growing that team and building that team, focusing on recovery, but also focusing on, as a state of New South Wales, across all of government, business, industry, community, how we better prepare for, respond to, you know, and bounce back from major disasters and emergencies or big disruptive events.
I know you've said that you're going to be wearing a suit in your new role, but can we still expect to see you in the yellows every now and again?
Yeah, well, you know what, two things. It's going to be really hard making decisions every day about shirt colours and tie combinations. I don't know how that's going to go. The suits I've got probably won't do up around my waist, and they're probably unfashionable, so I'll need to go shopping at some stage when the shops reopen to get a new wardrobe. But yes, I was up at my local brigade stations. I'm always a life member of the Duffy's Forest Brigade, which is wonderful. I don't get up there very often, so I might be able to get up there now and say hello every now and then. But my local brigade in Barara, I called in the other night and we did some interviews up there for late night TV, and the local captain was there, and I said, oh, I might even join up the brigade. And he said, oh, we've been in today with members. And I thought, geez, you're going to push me back already? So no, he said I'll be open to join, but they're already telling me I might have to reset all my basic firefighter again. So I'm looking forward to it. I'll just have to see what time I've got, but I certainly do miss the brigade. And even over the last decade or so, every now and then, I've really enjoyed getting out and particularly doing some hazard reduction burning or the odd shift here and there with the brigade. It's something I've always missed. And maybe if I get a bit of time, I'll be able to get back into and do something about that and join up in the yellows as well.
So just finally, you've always been one of the most vocal supporters of volunteering and the volunteer culture. What's your parting message to RFS volunteers?
Thank you. Thank you for what you do and why you do it. Without volunteers, as a society, as communities, as a state of New South Wales, as a country, we would be stuffed. Without volunteers, there is no RFS. And I would challenge anybody to work through their community and try and find something that functions well and not find volunteers that underpin it. Everything we do in society, even this new role that I'm going to, recovery and resilience, the core of good recovery and resilience is community-led. It's all those volunteers at the community level, working with business, working with local government, working with communities, that all come together. You think about everything from education, all the volunteerism in everything from PNCs to helping in the classroom, to helping in the canteens. You look at sport, kids' sport, adult sport, it just doesn't function without volunteers, you know, committing to the coaching, the administration, all those sorts of things. Healthcare, welfare in the local community, care at home, care for the disabled, it's underpinned by volunteers and families. Bush care, environment, you know, there's everything you can think of that functions in society. It is underpinned by volunteers. And right through to fire and emergency services, we are absolutely blessed here in New South Wales to have men and women right across the state that dedicate themselves to volunteering in this organisation. Without volunteers, there is no organisation. And lovely, of the very precious and valuable part that is the 1% of staff that make up the RFS, more than 70% of the staff are also volunteers. So volunteer culture is absolutely at the heart of the organisation. It's from the highest levels of leadership right through and out to the far reaches of the state. And I simply say thank you. Thank you. Keep going. Your operations, your commitment, your dedication has been viewed globally this season, and I don't think you could be held in any higher regard for what you do and the way you do it and for the difference you make in daily lives. Without volunteers, we would all be very much the poorer. So thank you.
Thank you.
No, thank you.
Thank you.